So let us move on to the next topic, which is classification of electrical components into active and passive components. So by active components, we mean that these components require external supply of power to be provided externally in order for them to function. So so far we've looked at resistances, capacitances, and inductors. All these components, as I mentioned here, do not require any external power supply to function. But this transistor is an active component and hence requires external supply of power. So here, the external supply is the collector current. So what exactly is the transistor is doing? It is amplifying the base current. So whenever it is working in the active mode, it does exactly this. So this equation can be written as IC equal to beta IB. So what I mean by this is the base current is being amplified by the transistor. So an NPN transistor is basically a P-type semiconductor sandwiched between two N-type semiconductors. So due to the sandwiching, there will be two junctions formed. So this is junction J1 and this J2. And we can see like the operation modes of this transistor based on the biasing conditions of this junction. So when the emitter based junction is forward biased and the collector based junction is reverse biased, we say that the transistor is working in the active mode. But whenever both the junctions are forward biased, then it works in the saturation mode. By saturation mode, we mean that it acts like a closed switch. So it just conducts. And then if both the junctions are reverse biased, obviously the transistor won't conduct at all. And then we say it is working in the cutoff mode. So this is analogous to an open switch. So and there's another case where the emitter based junction is reverse biased and the collector based junction is forward biased. But then this is not a practical use case of the transistor, so we will not consider this case at all. So now let us say we want to amplify any signal we are getting, and our transistors can help us do that. So using transistors, we can build something called as operational amplifiers. So these amplifiers are known to amplify any signal that is given to them, provided that it'll provide an external power supply. So these circuits have active components in them. So there are some other type of transistors, like field effect transistors. The transistor which we looked at just now is a bipolar junction transistor. So these bipolar junction transistors are current control devices. As we saw, the emitter current was dependent on the base current and the collector current. But the field effect transistor is designed in such a way that the current flowing through it is controlled by the voltage applied across the terminals of the transistor. So this is a voltage control device. So that is the main difference between BJT and FET. So you can look at some other sources where you can learn about how exactly this applying voltage determines the working of the FET. So here we have a schematic representation of an operational amplifier, where you given a certain input voltage and supply voltage, which is normally a DC voltage. So what it does is it just amplifies the input voltage. Say, for example, input voltage is like this. You supply some 15 volt to the amplifier, and basically the input voltage becomes huge. So these circuits use active components. And now moving on to the next concept, which is the dependent and independent sources. So by independent sources, we mean that they are fixed sources and they do not depend on any other parameter of the circuit. So for example, we have looked at a battery and a current source, so a constant current source. So these are example of the independent sources, because they're like a constant voltage source always provides a constant voltage irrespective of any other current or voltage across any other component in the circuit. But on the other hand, we have dependent sources which are variable, in the sense they depend on some kind of circuit parameters, like if there is this dependent voltage, say for example we have this dependent voltage, and this value will depend on some other resistor, some other current through this resistor located somewhere else in the circuit. So for example, if the current through the resistor is R, this can be like beta into IR. So this is what a dependent source exactly means. And then we have many different types of this dependent sources. The first one is current control voltage source, which I explained earlier, and the voltage control voltage source, which depends on the voltage across some other terminal, and the current controlled current source. So these are the different types of dependent voltage sources. Now, let us look at the gain stage of the amplifier. So whenever we have an amplifier, so like it gives us a gain on the input voltage and when you apply supply voltage to the amplifier. So the gain which we get on the input voltage is called as the gain stage. So in this case, the gain is K. So yeah, here all the quantities are linearly dependent. There's no such thing as a nonlinear dependence between any two dependent sources. So for example, here in this voltage controlled voltage source, this mu is a constant. It is not a variable. So yeah, this is what we are studying. And then coming to the next part, so like a bipolar junction transistor, as you can see, can be considered as a current controlled current source, and the field effect transistor can be regarded as a voltage controlled current source, because we saw that this mainly depends on the electric field applied across the terminals. So yeah, this is how an amplifier amplifies any signal. So yeah, and sometimes it can happen that the amplified signal might be out of the threshold value of the amplifier's output voltage. Like for example, you have supplied a supply voltage of only 15 volt, and the gain is so high that your VO is coming out to be around 18 volts. So what happens? It can't basically generate power out of nowhere. So what happens is anything above this 15 volt mark would be clipped off, and you will get only the part of the voltage which is under 15 and above minus 15. So here you can see this is the expected graph, but then what we are getting is a clipped out part. So yeah, this is one thing to be kept in mind. And there are two representations of an amplifier, so this is not as important as that. And then yeah, we define two terms. One is a voltage gain, which is denoted by AV, which is defined as VO by VI, and the current gain of the amplifier, which is output current divided by the input current. So if you multiply these two gains, we get something called as a power gain. So this power gain is nothing but the gain in power produced by the amplifier. So if you want the gain in dB, the power gain in dB, you just take the 20 log of the gain, normal gain. So this is how you calculate gain. And now let us see how an amplifier can be constructed. So here we have a voltage controlled voltage source. So what this source basically does is it depends on the input voltage applied across this RI, and produces a corresponding amplified voltage. And subsequently, this voltage is transferred into this load terminal, and we get an overall gain in the voltage. So yeah, that is basically how this amplifier works. And then moving on to lecture 12. So we have Thevenin's equivalent circuit, and then we consider that the Thevenin's effective voltage is constant at any instant only if the main circuit which we analyzed had constant sources. It should not have had any dependent or variable sources in it. So that is one thing to be kept in mind. And after studying all these things, we can do some circuit analysis on the capacitor and inductive circuits, where we look at how the current behaves as time progresses. So in all these circuits, there'll be two parts to the circuit. One is called as a natural phase, and then the other one is a forced phase, where in the natural phase, the circuit is like in a transient state. So by transient state, you mean that it is transitioning from a certain state to another state gradually. But then in a steady state, after some time, it gets adapted to the new situation, and the parameters do not change much. So this transient state is also called a natural response, and the steady state is called a forced response. And now we do some analysis with DC sources. So for example, if you have an RC circuit and a DC constant DC source, so by applying KVL and solving the differential equations, what we get is the expression of the voltage is K e power minus T by tau. So what do we mean by this? The voltage across this capacitor decreases in an exponential fashion. So initially it would be the exact amount of voltage which you apply in the input terminal, but then as time progresses, it decays exponentially. So this is for RC circuits. And so if you have by solving the differential equation, you'll be solving it for the homogeneous part and then the non-homogeneous part. So you'll have to add it up to get the final voltage or expression. So in general, you can like write it as A e power minus e by tau plus b. So this is the general form of the solution. And similarly, for the voltage and for current, it will be k naught e power minus t by tau. So due to linearity of the components, any parameter in the circuit can be expressed as in this fashion, where k1 and k2 can be found by suitable applying suitable conditions. So now we'll be looking at two main expressions in all these analysis. So let us see how their graph look like. The first one is the exponential function, and another one is the 1 minus exponential decrease function. So one just decays exponentially, which is e power minus e by tau, but the other 1 minus e power minus e by tau, it is similar to an inverted exponential function, where it has a upper limit, and it reaches the upper limit in infinite amount of time. So yeah, these are the two cases when you get the above two mentioned cases. Yeah, now we're looking at RL circuits. Since we've finished studying RC circuits, so now in RL circuits, the situation is entirely exactly the opposite. So here what happens is the current is given by A e power minus T by tau, and then the voltage will be 1 minus A e power minus, 1 minus E power minus T by tau. So that is about the inductive circuits. And now coming to another important question. So in RC circuits, there is something called as U-rate. So whenever you connect a voltage source to a capacitor, the voltage across the capacitor can't just jump like this in a certain instant. So it needs some time to go to that voltage, and then it starts exponentially decaying. So this time taken is dependent on the slew rate of the capacitor. So this is of the order of around if we say that this is around the 1 volt per 1 microsecond, like, this is very fast, so it is almost instantaneous, but this is not possible, because if that happens, the voltage across the resistor would be around 1000 volts for just the input of 5 volt. So this is defying the KVL, so that would not be possible. So it will take more, generally such circuits take more time to reach the initial state, and then they start discharging slowly. So for charging, you just apply this general equation and substitute the values for the parameters. You get that you get B of T is B O into 1 minus E power minus T by tau. So, and similarly for discharging of the circuit, you get the exact opposite, which is an exponential decay. So this is about charging and discharging of a capacitor in an RC circuit.